So, you know,
And we always often miss out looking on the third side of the picture. I think we always
yes.
see the black and the white. I mean, either it's a failure or either it's a success. I think in this world there are many people who are in this middle. I mean, they could not make it big and they don't want to lose and they are still in it and they're happy about it. Or they're satisfied with it and they've accepted it, right?
Yeah. So, hey guys, that's most welcome to our podcast episode number 6, and we have a special guest amongst us, and she is Deepti Rajan.
Hi Karthik, thanks for having me into your podcast.
So, Deep, the point is that people are self-identified a lot, and it gets ingrained into their self. So they're not able to disconnect from their identity. So what's your opinion on that? Like, how you perceive? That's what like we want to really talk about.
I think that's a very interesting topic to me, especially why. Just because I think this sort of identity crisis had always been part of people who have been immigrants, I believe. So, I mean, I think in India also we have this a very different culture, or let's say there is a big cultural shock when it comes to Northern India or Southern India, right? So, I'll tell you why I say that is because I've been raised and brought up in Delhi, okay. So, but I belong to the southernmost part of India, and so what happens is that when you go to schools and colleges over here, I mean, college is somewhere where you have now realized and you are your mind has developed at least to an extent where you can understand a lot of things. But when I was a kid, I always used to try to belong to someone, okay? Small questions I used to think and ponder on, and I wanted to, like, when I go out, I wanted to belong to them. And then when I'm at home, I want to belong to them also. When I'm home, I go, to my native, I want to belong to them. I don't want them to feel that I'm somebody different. So I would
But
dare.
you are, right? This is gonna show. They're gonna treat you something different, right?
That's
Because I remember, I similar to you, I belong to Odisha, right? So when I go back to Odisha, I don't fit there.
yeah, but then I have always used to feel left out on things. You say FOMO, fear of being left out. I always used to
Yeah.
feel, on missing out on things. I also feel that, okay, maybe when I'm here, I miss out on things, and when I go back, I'm missing out on those cultural lingos, or when you say, hey, bye, oh, yeah, these kind of things we say here, there, I miss out on saying, I don't really know what are those hip and happening joints over there. Here, I mean, there is always something you miss out.
This is something I tell about to all my friends and family members and cousins, that sometimes you can convert your weakness into strength. That's what I've seen, that even if you see Vidya Vox, okay, she tries to blend in her culture stuff. Like, she belongs to Chennai and tried to implement that beat into the English songs, right? And similarly, Lily Singh did. She added the Punjabi into her English video. They actually, what I got from them is that they accepted their not belongingness, and they accepted that it wholeheartedly, and that's what make them different and famous, I guess.
That is the case, anything, right? I mean, I'm just wondering, would you go back and tell your parents that, yeah, just started working in a pizza joint? Would they be saying, yeah, great, that's something we wanted to, you wanted you to become? Like, I don't think they think that way. Okay, for an example.
I'm gonna just, just something which comes to mind, like, I'm gonna just take you back. They self-identify themselves through you. He is my kid. So what he does kind of reflects on me. So that's why they are so conscious about it. If you say you own the pizza joint, now that gives another self-identification, which is good for them,
For an example, okay, early in my career, I wanted to be an I didn't wanted to pursue this choice. I just when I was a kid, probably around when I've not even started my college days, I think I had visited my grandmother. So I just used to tell that I want to become an designer someday. So in her view, designer was somebody like a tailor. So you want to become a tailor. You want to stitch clothes. Okay, so you want to stitch clothes, right? She just looked upon that career as it was was some local.
Some menial job, kind of.
Menial job, right?
Now we are gonna go towards a new topic. Is something is about the generation gap, and now this is something very relatable in the sense when you say generation, a generation identifies itself through its cultural impact they had already gone through. Okay, and that's how they've identified. Maybe the music, you know, we will always say that the 90s music would be best, or the people who are born like in the 70s music were best, you know. So I think this is a recurring a topic, like the generation itself have identified it to something and they can't switch it back to other things.
So don't you think every year there is a generation gap? I mean, look at the kids nowadays. I mean, I feel already an old school. Okay, I mean, I still believe on those old. I do keep up with the latest things, but there is a lot of things that changes in every year. I think it just changes drastically.
And this leads me to the next question: reality versus persona. So when you are entertaining somebody, and people have actually told to me, when you roast, you have like a different energy to it. You seems like a different person. But that what is all about? I have to entertain you in that video. So I can't be my authentic self of, this is my authentic self of like when I'm talking to somebody. So the point being is, what happens if you live in a persona all the time? Okay. So like, what is your take on reality versus persona? Yeah.
I think we tend to be different for different people, for different audiences,
exactly.
Isn't it? I think even if you go to workplace, you have a presentation, you don't look or you don't sound yourself. You need to bring in that sort of energy. Maybe every day you don't talk with that energy to everyone, hey, or welcome, or you don't use that lingo, you don't use those gestures or thank you for coming. I mean, you can use it to a friend. I'm grateful you're here, but your friend, I may not tell you every time. But in a video or in presentation or in certain audience, you need to be a bit different. But I agree, you need to be real, but still add on the beautiful pieces. I mean,
exactly.
You can't just put your raw self out.
It's very hard to change.
But then, I mean, when you started on this journey, don't you think these opinions, these thoughts, or I think you got your hate message, it would impact you at some certain point of, I think I know I'm a bit diverted from the topic.
No, but no, it's all good. Actually, this is very interesting. And the first thing which I would tell everybody is not that easy. Okay, you are all humans and you're gonna feel it. It is not gonna, you can, even if you want to ignore it, it is not easy. Like a lot of advice will come to you that you just ignore it. But once you have read it, how can you ignore it ever? How you put things like just back of the mind? You know, if you read it, you know it, and then that's it. How do you, and what you felt is also gonna remain it. So my point being is that you need to have that neuroplasticity, mental plasticity of like, it has to be kind of elasticity in your mind. It takes off the content, it kind of absorbs the pressure, but it doesn't break you. Okay, and the elasticity would come back to its original state. So this needs to happen. And this is like a journey, you have to do it from your inner. It's a like an inner journey, you have to do it. Because it is going to happen. I don't recommend the people who can't handle that. This is will be a hell from for them. Hell for them.
So do you go and read every message or mail or let it be a positive or a negative one?
I do.
What sort of do you prepare yourself before reading certain content or
you
certain
have to
comments.
Prepared every time because the message is gonna go and come in boom.
So do you feel that it is easy to absorb that sort of negativity and then move on, or do you take measures, or like how do you cope up with that? For an example, somebody asked you, I understand the take you would do is probably you would you would face what sort of negativity he thinks is in your content, and you will try to address that, right? But deep down, when you go home, right, you would feel a sense of being rejected or being I'm not sure, like, what sort of feeling would you have, or you would just leave that in that show, or leave that there in that talk, or just...
I would tell you something very, which we were talking about earlier also. Like, as an YouTuber also, or a video creator, I have created that content. So I identify through it. If my content gets rejected, I get rejected. So I have identified through it. So yeah, if you don't identify with your content, you also can't put your personality, put your effort, put your ideas into it. You have to get identified with it. That is the risk you're gonna take. And yeah, you feel rejected, but that's what I'm trying to say. That some people survive in the entertainment industry as well. Some people don't. Yeah, so because they are able to handle that pressure. So
you always often miss out looking on the third side of the picture. I think we always see the black and the white. Either it's a failure or either it's a success. I think in this world there are many people who are in this middle. They could not make it big and they don't want to lose, and they are still in it and they're happy about it, or they're satisfied with it and they've accepted it, right?
Yeah.
Many have. Deep down you do want to make it big, but it's okay, right?
It's okay, but because it's okay because I'm doing what I like, which is what is happiness, in the sense, where you find your own happiness.
I have understood so far is that, that this is a very bookish or a very common answer that everybody gives me or tells me or advises me is that, it's in your present. And if you're happy now, if you're happy doing certain things, and that's enough. You need not associate your happiness in a certain achievement.
I think it's a very good advice.
Somewhere deep down, it becomes difficult for me to absorb it. It does not reach out to my every bit part of my body.
You have the knowledge, but not the clarity, in the sense, because for example, if you don't dissociate happiness from success, okay, then you're gonna still be in that limbo. You're not successful, you're not happy. You're not successful, you're not happy. So basically, this podcast is available in iTunes, Spotify, Google Podcast. So we have it in variety of mediums in available. So go to your favorite, broadcaster and just listen to it. And I will try to give you a video of it, which is more consumable for the audience. And so catch you in the next podcast. Thank you.
Thank you.